And thank you to our From the Field sponsors. This project is funded in part by Jody K. Kingdon and Henry S. Kingdon, doctor and PhD, and a grant from the Sauk County UW Extension Arts and Culture Committee and the Wisconsin Arts Board with funds from the state of Wisconsin. To learn more about sponsoring one of our webinars, please contact Kate Fitzwilliams. We are excited to have you join us for our fourth presentation in the Cranes and Community Virtual Arts Series. This fall, the International Crane Foundation will host a series of five webinars showcasing artists with strong ties to Sauk County. The Cranes and Community Virtual Arts Series will highlight the work of five gifted artists, including Jay Jocham, Kim Russell, Janet Flynn, Elliott Funmaker Sr., Masako Pellerin, and artists will have an opportunity to discuss what inspires them, talk about their artistic process, and share stories. And today we are delighted to have Jay Jocham share his presentation, Behind the Scenes Look at Painting the International Crane Foundation Exhibit Murals. Welcome, Jay.
Hi, Kelly. Thanks for having me.
For 30 years, Jay Jocham has created art that has helped conservation groups fund programs to protect wildlife. As a successful painter, Jay has shown his work extensively and twice been included in the prestigious Birds in Art International Exhibit in Wausau, Wisconsin. A lifetime love of nature influenced Jay's career as an artist. In the summer of 2009, a 1,600 square foot mural was painted by Jay in our Blue Crane exhibit at the International Crane Foundation. Jay returned in 2020 to assist the International Crane Foundation with completing improvements, including six new panoramic background murals. 9,000 square feet of murals were painted by Jay over 12 months, starting in April of 2019 and completed in just this past September of 2020. Thank you, Jay, for joining us today.
Thank you.
My name is Kali Shelton. I'm the Visitor Program Manager at the International Crane Foundation, and I've worked here for the past 10 years. I love spending time here in Sauk County and really enjoy birding, canoeing, picnicking, hiking with my family and friends. At this time, Jay and I are going to turn off our videos so that you can ensure that you hear our audio throughout the entire presentation and to make certain that everything works correctly today. So Jay, you and I at this time will stop our videos. And okay. Jay, one of the things that I wanted to have you start with by having you share with us, how did you begin to work with the International Crane Foundation to paint all of these phenomenal murals?
Well, I'd like to say the journey of 1,100 feet of murals started in April 2019 with one cold and soggy step. Mm-hmm. But it officially began over a year earlier with a planning meeting at the beginning of January 2019 or 2018. It may have truly begun over 10 years earlier at the painting of the Blue Crane mural with its popularity over time, which I think kind of set the groundwork for the future vision of these murals. Mm. And if you go back even further, when I arrived in central Wisconsin 26 years ago, I was immediately captivated by sandhill cranes in my neighborhood. Having moved here from my position as art director at the Milwaukee Zoo, it didn't take long for cranes to appear in my paintings. The artwork you see here, the dancing whooping cranes, was a commission from Frater Hospital in Milwaukee for their cancer ward. And the upper right one of the preening red crown was in Birds and Art, I think in 2003. Mm. Just around that time, before that time, actually, I sought out ICF and George Archibald, beginning many creative partnerships over the years.
They're beautiful. And Jay, as you continue to paint cranes, I know that your work then led to begin to assist the International Crane Foundation. How did it then begin to be part of your mural project?
Well, the murals, these latest murals began with conversations with Darcy Love and Dr. Archibald and a series of planning meetings starting, as I said, in January 2018. ICF had specific ideas for a narrative background in each exhibit. You'll see some notes there of a sample of what ICF was after. Cully, you were also an active voice in those meetings, so you can add some insight here.
Right.
We discussed designs. We developed, edited, refined, and approved over the course of a year. ICF wanted backgrounds that fully told the story of these birds and their worldly travels, showing habitats, cultures, environmental threats. Here, pictured below, the black-necked begins from a wintering valley with a temple in Bhutan and transitions over the Himalayas where the birds fly to nesting grounds on the Tibetan plateau, shared with nomadic tents and yaks.
And I know all of this great work that you had put into the black-necked crane mural planning, you also then began to develop the other exhibits as we continued to meet together as a group. And this is an image of the SARS crane exhibit that you helped to create.
Right. My goal as an artist was to take the ideas and develop illustrations fusing diverse and meaningful habitats. And as you can see, they span three continents, from summer to wintering areas. And this had to be done over 9,000 square feet of exhibit wall. Here, the SARS depicts nesting in wet forests of Southeast Asia to wintering in populated agricultural areas in India. And as a rhino fan, I always try to add a rhino to artwork that I'm working on. And I actually had an Indian rhino in this illustration, and it was ultimately removed for reasons of narrative. But ultimately, ICF would approve the designs for go ahead for painting. So the challenge was to illustrate these transitions from summering to wintering areas. For example, the red crown crane design begins on the left as summering and nesting grounds in the vast wetlands of China and transitions across the Sea of Japan to a wintering area in Hokkaido. Many times these transitions were successfully made across the walls of the holding building as a natural link from one area to the other. So ultimately we had to plan six separate transitions. Here's one more example, the white-naped wintering area in the Korean DMZ. That would be on the very bottom of this illustration.
Jay, then too, I know once all of this planning had occurred, then how did you actually go to take this from your drawings and the illustrations to then these beautiful, very much larger spanses of a mural?
Well, the season started each year on a cold spring night, ideally under a new moon, so ambient light would not dilute the projection. The designs were scaled at 1 inch to a foot on a grid and projected on the walls. The outlines were sketched out with graphite about 8 feet at a time. The reason why we try to do this without light, in 2009, when I first did this, I was out there and there was a full moon in the sky and the moon was so bright, I couldn't see the projection on the wall. So we always go for a new moon. So there's no light, ambient light shining on it. So as it turned out, the first big challenge wasn't the mud or the cold, but the rough sandpaper like stucco walls as they chewed through a dozen construction pencils the very first night. It was all we could do to keep them sharp for me to sketch out the projection. 3 days later, a bomb cyclone hit the site and scoured most of the graphite off of the south-facing wall, leaving only faint markings. So I had to darken the lines that were washed off by the storm. From then on, we used graphite sticks to draw on the walls because graphite leaves a heavier line and never needs sharpening. As it turned out, the first two walls that were sketched out were surrounded by water for most of 2019 and weren't to be painted until 2020. It was also at this time we started using a smartly fabricated tripod from Ted Thousand. Thanks, Ted. With a fancy self-leveling platform so we could project more efficiently on uneven terrain and many times in the mud. The walls were cement blocks covered with stucco and were 7.5 feet to 12.5 feet in height. The stucco was then coated with block primer to create a reasonably smooth surface to paint on. On this slide, you can see the painted unprimed stucco, and then one coat of primer is on the left hand of the stucco, so we ended up doing two coats. The paint we used was a high-quality, non-toxic exterior acrylic. We used nearly 40 gallons of EcoSpran paint on the project, and to seal the painting from weather and sun, two coats of EarthSafe UV varnish were applied to protect each mural, and we used nearly 20 gallons of finish. After a few days of heavy spring rain in 2019, it was finally warm enough to paint. Generally, painting occurred in temperatures in the mid-50s to the upper 80s so the paint could dry properly. However, we extended work days by painting in the sun when it was cold. That was mostly for me to stay warm, and painting in the shade when it was hot, or painting under the building overhang when it was threatening rain. I also had a portable sun shelter to move around when the sun was too hot on the wall. I estimated that we needed 200 painting days to complete the project, so the weather being too cold or too hot or too rainy would limit working days. Ultimately, we finished at 190 days of painting from May through September over two summers.
Wow.
Due to the rough and porous texture of stucco and its ability to soak up paint and shred brushes, we found out early on that we would have to apply two coats of primer to the walls prior to painting. Many thanks to John and Cookie Miller for volunteering nearly 100 hours of their summer, smoothing out over 6,400 square feet of surface for me to paint on. And special thanks to my daughter, Anna. Hi, Anna. For also helping with projecting, priming, and sealing, especially in a pandemic year. I very much appreciated the help that these folks gave me to keep me on schedule. And you'll hear from my notes here that it was important that we stayed on schedule. In the end, the walls consumed 20 brushes of varying sizes and over a dozen roller covers and pads. And as it turned out, the fourth wall we actually worked on was the first wall to actually be painted. Only the first 12 feet of the hooded crane exhibit was primed and painted to make sure the paint adhered well to the surface. And normally I paint a greater expanse here from top to down, so it's the background to the foreground. But here I started out with one wall section to make sure the primer, paint, and caulk would all work well on the wall. For the summer of 2019, cold and wet weather were constant, but another challenge for much of the summer was avoiding heavy construction equipment needing to work in the same exhibit. Oddly, the high visibility vest that I was given and hard hat never made me feel quite safe enough. Although my feathered neighbor made me smile with her response to the constant beep, beep, beep of the trucks, I could often hear the crowned crane in a nearby exhibit answering the backup alarm of the big machines, going beep, 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 honk, honk, honk. So with her encouragement, the hooded wall was underway.
And this is the wall that everyone can see here, the beautiful hooded crane mural having been completed at that time. And Jade, then you moved on to another mural after the hooded crane had been completed.
Right on the other side of the wall was the red crowned left-hand portion. As I mentioned earlier, these were the only complete walls that didn't have water around them. That's why we started here on the north side of the building. So that was, the Red Crown was started in late spring. And on this particular picture, you can notice a small paint spill where I tripped over a gallon of paint. And I did that twice on this wall. And then I kind of learned my lesson because I never did it again. I'm always stepping back to look at the wall. So I sometimes early on didn't remember where I left a bucket and knocked that one over. These chunks could be removed after they dried after about a day or two and disposed of properly because it's acrylic, so that was easy to move out of there. Mm. Generally, it would take about a month to complete a 200-foot wall, as you see here. So the right wall was started around midsummer. And one interesting phenomenon occurred throughout the first painting season. And looking at these pictures, you see about two courses of block being exposed. Well, these exhibits had to be filled up to the bottom, within 3 inches of the bottom of these murals. So topsoil had to be brought into each exhibit. And in this case, swarms of black flies arrived with the dirt piles. Fortunately, the insects lessened after the soil was spread out and exposed to sun and rain. But there always seemed to be some sort of weekly hatch of flies or beetles that would land in the wet paint. I became somewhat of an expert at flicking flies and spiders off the wall with the tip of a brush. Another neat bit of nature happened in the RCC wall where there were tree branches I painted there. A dragonfly chose to land on a branch and perch there for quite some time, so I was able to capture that image to share.
Yeah, that's fun to see.
It was during this time the Blue Crane exhibit began to be reinstalled. For those that don't already know, the Blue Crane mural was painted on 4x8 wooden panels. These panels were painstakingly taken down and stored during construction. The panels were then reinstalled on concrete walls, and you can see that happening here. And as most know, Blue Crane seemed to enjoy the companionship of their two-dimensional cousins. So ICF had to install mural images in their off-exhibit home to help them feel more comfortable. And watching the Blue Cranes embrace their home again was a treasured moment.
And Jay, I know you have a video that you'd like to share with us, so I'm going to advance ahead.
So they were back again.
Thank you, Jay, for sharing that video, especially of Quito and Periwinkle coming back together in that Blue Crane exhibit. It's fun to see that and imagine, as you described, how accustomed they became to their own, you know, two-dimensional cousins there on the wall. And as you continued, you also added cranes to the additional murals. And I know this is the start of the Eurasian Crane mural.
Right. August of 2019 was spent on the Eurasian Crane wall. And you can see here my bench and scaffolding, because I can reach comfortably to the top of the wall with my 8-foot bench. My bench could reach 8 feet, but we needed scaffolding to reach the 10.5-foot height of that wall on the left-hand side. So ICF let me borrow their scaffolding to reach the top portion of that wall. And I want to thank Tom Davis for helping me to move it around. And here we see the Eurasian well underway and nearing completion. Hmm. So in September, I began painting the sky in the Black Crown exhibit. The scaffolding was moved there to reach the top of that wall. That left-hand side of that wall was 12.5 feet. And many of my designs have cultural patterns painted into the murals. In the upper right hand of this one is a regional design often seen on fabric. So these designs were meant to add cultural context to the backgrounds where the cranes live. And October was challenging last year with cold and damp mornings and swift sunsets. 2 days after reaching the halfway point of the project, it snowed and temperatures never rebounded.
And I know, Jay, that then came to the end of the 2019 painting season, and that having been completed, you just started painting again this past spring in 2020.
Right. We were at it again at the end of April with projecting. And after a brief delay for COVID-19 restrictions, it was determined I could work safely again, and that we jumped right on the SARS exhibit wall. It would be the right wall of the SARS exhibit. We projected and started painting the right wall on April 30th. And here again, you can see traditional henna pattern over the sky in India, which adds a little cultural flavor to that wall. This wall faces west and was cool in the morning and warm in the afternoon. It was good at painting until about late May, when it started to get really, really warm. So we had to put up the sun shelter again to paint under. So this held true for the south-facing source wall as well, that received sun morning until late afternoon. The length of that wall being 218 feet, I believe, we worked on that for most of the beginning of the summer. So here's a panorama of the finished source wall exhibit. That's actually viewed from the Welcome Center walkway. Since the fencing was installed over the winter months, some of the walls in 2020 had to be painted on the outside of the exhibit and around the fencing. And as a nature lover, I enjoyed my outside experiences. After the ponds went in, the tadpoles and resulting frogs were really fun entertainment. There were daily migrations of frogs into and out of the building and up and down the walls. And unlike the insects, frogs could always be encouraged to move along without much intervention. As the murals began to be completed, we tried our best to protect the painted surfaces from ground splatter by using plastic coverings, plastic ground coverings, but inevitably splatters occurred. And cleaning debris off of sealed surfaces is much easier. So we tried to protect them with coats of UV finish as soon as we could after painting. Mm-hmm. And as vegetation began growing in the exhibits, especially during the second year, ground splatter was less of a concern because the water would, you know, land on the vegetation and not splatter dirt back up on the wall. As June began to get warmer, I moved into the white-naped crane exhibit, where the north-facing wall was in the cool shade for most of the day. The white-naped exhibit was finished in mid-August, and the murals around the building were complete and ready for occupancy. And here we'll see an elevated panorama of the new exhibits.
And Jay, as you had been describing for everyone joining us today, when they see this image, the image on the murals on the left there with closest to that wetland, that's the white-naped crane exhibit that you were just talking about. And then just to the right of that image is the SARS crane exhibit that you had been describing to us. And so I know that, as you had mentioned, the joy of seeing the birds begin and return to then these exhibits as well.
Right, and those daily interactions I really enjoyed. And I do have to mention, you know, 2019, with all the construction and the hustle and bustle of all the building, it was much quieter in 2020. And those walks to my exhibit to paint every morning were quiet walks by myself and with the birds. And that's really, really a special time that I learned while working at the zoo, when people aren't around and you're with the animals. They tend to be a little bit more relaxed and they can be themselves, I think, a little bit more. And it just seeing their personalities was really enjoyable for me. I really love their interactions with intruders. The daily flyovers by wild sandhills gliding down to Grammy's Marsh were fun to witness, when every ICF crane would bugle in unison at their wild cousins passing overhead. And I was always able to tell when a human was walking past a pair's territory. As a kind of a security alarm, I was able to judge the time between the arrival of a visitor to my location, back tucked away in the back northwestern portion of the site where I was painting the black-necked exhibit. So I could always tell when somebody was walking past their exhibits, because they would do a territorial bugle and to announce their arrival.
And Jay, I like these images that you're sharing with all of our participants today. The Eurasian cranes are in the lower left image, and the white-naped crane in that upper right image. And as you described, it's going to be a wonderful experience for our members and our visitors to have these up close personal opportunities to observe the birds safely within their own spaces and have your murals behind them. So it's fun to hear, as you had described, all of the ways in which, as an artist, you had observed the birds in those spaces and, you know, imagining what our visitors are going to have a chance to experience as well. And I know, as you said, with the warning that they would provide to you, you were starting to then hear more of those as the birds returned to their exhibits, but there was still another mural to finish.
Right. The final mural began in August and was completed in September. The black-necked exhibit was more isolated from the other exhibits, but I had always had the cranes for companionship. The whooping cranes would stand watch on the hill where they could see the white-naped cranes to make sure the other birds understood that was their territory. And that'll be just over the back of the wall that I was painting here. They would give a territorial unison call. And for about a week, that worked against the white-naped. But after about a week, they started to answer back. The white-naped were polite at first, but they would respond to the calls robustly as they settled into their new home. On that last slide, you could see the whooping cranes on the top of the hill facing the white-naped. And they did that every morning for a while, which was pretty entertaining as well.
I'm sure that whooping crane was keeping track of you too, thinking about where you all were. So.
Yeah, because I would be standing on my bench or the ladder, and my head would pop over the top of the wall, and their heads would swivel towards me as well.
Yes.
Black-necked was fun to paint because it was basically one long wall where the end was always in sight. It never got really too hot, but some September mornings were too cool to start early. And I was also aware of the time-lapse camera running during this time and was a bit conscious being watched. One behavioral oddity was how often I would step away from the wall to see how the mural was coming along. Luckily, that was edited out of the video. It looks very different from 2 feet away compared to the view from the visitor platform. So I put on hundreds of extra steps each day, walking back and forth to see my progress. My fitness tracker said that I had walked across the Serengeti, so I've got that going for me.
Absolutely. And Jay, tell us, what are you doing in this picture?
That's the finish of the black-necked wall, the very end. I did actually sign and date each mural in the corner. So the weather actually dictated each season's end. In 2019, I achieved 50% completion by the end of October after the wettest year on record. We had over 45 inches of rain that fell during the painting timeframe. In 2020, the weather was drier, but by the end of September, we were able to just complete the two-year project. And it turned out October was to be the third coldest on record. So we actually finished just in time with maybe a week to spare.
Wow.
Last year, there were safety vests and hard hats and construction protocols to follow. This year, there were masks and COVID-19 protocols to follow. There were physical, mental, and creative challenges, but this project was extremely rewarding. And it was an experience of my lifetime helping to create these backdrops for these important birds. And seeing Marianne Wellington drive by in a golf cart holding a Broga crane on her lap was priceless. Thank you, International Crane Foundation, for giving me this opportunity and for doing the work you do for cranes. I really appreciate it.
Well, Jay, thank you so much too for sharing with us a behind the scenes look at painting these phenomenal murals at the International Crane Foundation. We are just so fortunate to have your talent and expertise to assist us in sharing these stories of the places that these cranes dance all around our planet. And one of the things that I know we wanted to share with everyone is a time-lapse video. And this is a time-lapse video of you working on the blackneck crane exhibit. And so what we're going to do is just get set up for the video. And this video was created and shared with International Crane Foundation members as an exclusive benefit of membership. And if you want to be the first to view new content, we invite you to become a member today. So I'm going to play the video here. Thank you, Jay, for letting us share that video with everyone so that we had an opportunity to see what it was like for you to do this painting of these very phenomenal, beautiful murals at the International Crane Foundation. And we could see that you had the scaffolding there and that you were working on a section of that wall where there is a temple from Bhutan where they host the Blackneck Crane Festival on an annual basis. So I know that's part of that story that you were helping us to illustrate at that time. And one of the things we're really excited for, all of us who are participating in our webinar today, and for those of you who may have an opportunity to travel to visit the International Crane Foundation, we will be hosting the Crane event, our grand opening on May 1st of 2021. And we are excited to have you come and see these murals in person and all of the hard work that Jay Jocham had completed for us. So Jay, thank you again very much for providing us the behind the scenes look at painting the International Crane Foundation exhibit murals. At this time, we're going to move towards questions from our ICF members and webinar participants. And I'd like to introduce Ben Lamb, our education program coordinator with the International Crane Foundation. Ben's gonna help us facilitate the question and answer session next.
Hello, everyone. It's great to be on. I loved hearing, you know, more about the murals, especially, you know, having walked through the exhibits and seeing them slowly, you know, come to be what they are now. So thanks so much, Jay, for, you know, explaining a lot more about your process and everything. So we do have some questions here. And I guess I'll start us off first with a question from Leslie. And her question is, how long do the murals last before you need to do any repainting?
That's a good question. When we did the Blue Crane exhibit, and that one is 11 years old now, the paint and the finish really, after that long period of time, really aren't the problem. It was the substrate. It was painted on wood. And that started rotting from the bottom up and the top down. So we're hoping that the cement walls will last much longer. We do every 3 to 5 years, we come back. Now that this is going to be kind of a much bigger job, but the south facing wall of the Blue Crane needed a new coat of UV varnish every 3, 4, or 5 years. And so that was recoated, I think, 3 times. And the north facing wall much less because it doesn't receive much sun at all. So we recoated that once in that this 10, 11 year time frame. So I'm expecting it to last a long time. As long as the wall lasts underneath the paint, I think it'll be there for a long time.
Awesome. That's great to hear. Yeah, that's a big question that I've heard from others as well. So I appreciate you answering that. I have a next question here from Diana. And Diana asks, so for the cultural environmental aspects of murals, did you research these online or have you traveled to these countries and experienced it yourself?
No, for the most part, I did not travel there. Much of this reference came from ICF and their travels. George Archibald is very widely traveled, and he travels to a lot of these areas. Plus, a lot of the staff, ICF staff, does travel to these areas, and they bring back tons of photographic reference. So when we started these meetings, there was a wealth of reference material for me to start with. And I did a little filling in on my own to fill out the narratives, and some of the animals had to be more fully researched, and because they were specific species that had to be painted in some of these murals. So I hope that answers the question. I mean, I'd love to be able to travel to all these areas, but time and finances didn't dictate that. So we did the best we could with what we had access to.
Yeah, thanks, Jay. I guess going off of that, out of all of the murals that you've painted for us, is there any one of those places that you'd like to visit the most?
I think the black-necked exhibit, Bhutan, looks fascinating. I've always wanted to visit the Himalayas, and that whole story fascinates me. The crane, how they can fly over the tallest mountains in the world, and on a bi-yearly basis, it's a fascinating, and culturally it looks like a fascinating place to visit.
Yeah, I definitely agree. That's definitely on my list of places to visit too, hopefully somewhere in the future. Hopefully you will be able to visit too.
Yeah, maybe someday.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we have another question here, and someone is interested in what type of brushes did you use for painting?
The stiffest synthetic brushes I could find that could hold up to acrylic paint, because they're hard on brushes. You definitely don't want to let it dry, but they withstood the cleaning really well. So detail wise, I got down to about maybe a quarter inch. I used a half inch brush a lot of time for the detail work. And those brushes went up to about 4 inches in width for larger areas like skies and mountains. For some of the background areas, we used really heavy nap rollers. I had 3-inch rollers and I had 9-inch rollers. So if we needed to cover a portion of the sky, quickly, that would be the way to go, because then you could just paint clouds over the top of the blue paint. I happen to have this here, thinking maybe somebody would ask that question. Here's a 1/4-inch brush before and after. The brushes start out with about this length of bristle. This is a brush, the same exact brush after a year of painting on those walls. So it actually would just sand down the bristles of the brush. And I keep this brush because it really was helpful getting underneath and around things, because the shorter that they got, the more stiffer they got. That's what I mean by eating through a brush, because it just, painting on it just sands down the tips. So.
Yeah, thanks, Jay. I appreciate you having those brushes available too, to see. That's a huge, huge difference.
I've got a whole studio full of them here. So I just happen to have them in case somebody wanted to ask about them. So
mm-hmm. Thanks for being ready.
Yep.
All right. So we have another question here, and it's about inspiration. This is from Roseanne. So with, I guess, art and creating things, inspiration is a big thing. She asked, what inspired you to paint murals?
ICF asked me to do it, and it's a project that you can't say no to, because it's like, as an artist, there are certain opportunities that you just can't pass up, and this was one of them. The inspiration comes from the cranes. Who cannot be inspired by cranes? And I love birds and I love cranes, so they inspire me. And I paint cranes because I want to inspire others. And, that's what the Crane Foundation is all about. And they know that people begin to love these birds, and they realize that they have to protect the habitats to protect the birds. And it turns out, the world can be a better place when that happens. So, that's my inspiration.
That's great to hear. Thanks, Jay. All right. So our next question here is from Terrence. So you mentioned visits by dragonflies and frogs. Did you ever get any bird visitors?
Constantly. Mostly, songbirds, sparrows, finches, blue jays, crows. Birds would come in all the time. Not so much in 2019, but in 2020, the netting didn't stop them. In fact, had some instances with mourning doves. They were great at getting into an exhibit, but not so great at getting out. And so I had to kind of shepherd them out of the exhibit sometimes in the mornings when I'd come, and they'd be panicking, flying around. They couldn't get out. So I would have to open up the gates and kind of herd them out so they could fly out of the exhibits. Ground squirrels started to make their homes in there. And so I've been startled several times when a ground squirrel would just walk between my legs while I'm painting. And it's kind of unnerving, but they were part of the exhibits too. So going back to the birds, they love the water features, you know, as much as the cranes do now. They would come in there to enjoy the water, take baths, take drinks, and you know, probably help themselves to some tadpoles and some insects down there too. So yeah, they were always around.
Thanks, Jay. Yeah, that's great to hear that you had some company, you know, with the other wildlife while you're painting. Sounds great. All right, so our next question here is from Bonnie. Bonnie is wondering if, do you sell any of the prints of your paintings, such as the preening Red Crown Crane from 2003?
Not that one, no. I do have some prints. The freighter art of the whooping cranes dancing was made into a print. I still have some of those left. I'm not sure. I don't have too many prints left, but I still have some of those. Occasionally I do make prints, but I don't have a lot of inventory right now. So.
Gotcha. So Jay, if anyone wanted to buy a print from you, where should they go?
I guess the best thing to do is to go to my website and just leave me a note, and I give them some more information. I used to have a shopping page, but things didn't move fast enough for me, and it was too much work to keep it updated. So now I just do it by contact. So.
That sounds good. And to visit Jay's website, it is www.jjocham.com. I did list it in the chat as well, if you'd like easy access to click it.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. So our next question here, someone asked from, or Nina asked, what was it like being there at night working?
Kind of spooky. You know, it's always cold and damp at night, and with the dew and everything. Most of it, my daughter Anna was helping me, and that really helps to have companionship. So when you're by yourself, it's a little bit unnerving. I had a deer. I think it was. When I was in the White Nape, a deer came up out of, must have been like in the Grammy Marsh area. And it came up, you could always see tracks. Like when I would come in the morning, I would see tracks through the sand, especially in 2019, they'd come up to investigate, and 2020 didn't slow them down either. But I came across a deer a couple of times walking to and from out of the exhibit and they come up right walk around the exhibits, and I saw their footprints on the concrete, and you know, when there's nobody around, they just they make themselves at home.
I think that's really cool to hear, because I don't think many people have that perspective to see what it's like in the exhibits at night. So that's pretty cool to hear.
And coming across another large body like that at night is gets your blood pressure up a little bit. So
yeah, I bet. All right. So our next question is from Leslie. Leslie asks, do you have a preference for painting murals versus smaller formats?
The murals are a specific challenge. You know, your wall is, vertical, it's perpendicular to the ground. And it's normally when I paint, you can see my drawing board behind me, it's just at a slight angle up. So it's a different way of painting. It has different challenges. I prefer painting in studio. It's quiet. It's dry. It's not hot. It's not cold. I don't have to worry about bugs. So I would prefer painting inside, absolutely. But having the opportunity to do this outside was pretty special. And so I would do it again.
That's great to hear. We really appreciate your work too, and you taking this project on. So we have a question from Ian, and Ian says, great work, Jay. Would you travel to other parts of the world to also paint murals? And specifically an example of Botswana, Africa?
I probably would if I had the opportunity. I joke about living in Wisconsin. You can only paint from May to September in Wisconsin, but you can paint in other parts of the world during our winter. So, especially someplace warmer would be inviting, I think. So yeah, if I had the opportunity, I would.
That's great to hear. I hope, just like for your other travels that you mentioned, that an opportunity like that opens up for you. Mm. All right, so let's see. So we have another question here, and we're wondering, so what are your plans after this project? Where does your journey take you next?
I've got plenty of ideas for a personal painting for myself. As Colleen mentioned earlier in my bio, I do enter birds and art every year, and I create paintings just for enjoyment. So I think just in the short term right now, and I don't ever look too far ahead, but just for the winter, I'll just be painting in the studio here and creating new artwork.
That sounds good. And I guess I'm wondering, do you have a favorite subject to paint?
I've settled in on birds, I think. I had mentioned rhinos earlier. I've painted lots of rhinos in my day, but in these last 30 years or so, I've settled on endangered species because I think it's important to portray them give people the opportunity to, to get to know them and to love them and hopefully save the environments that they are part of.
Thanks, Jay. All right, so we're going to wrap up our questions portion now. So thank you so much for answering our questions, Jay. I have one last question for Cully. Cully, can you please describe to our viewers how they could help the International Crane Foundation's mission and work?
Absolutely, Ben. Thank you. We are a donor-supported organization. So one of the best ways is by becoming a member of the International Crane Foundation. And you can consider making a donation by going to our website at www.savingcranes.org. Also, as Jay had just shared with us about sharing the story of endangered species, including the crane species, is a great way to help build support and raise awareness for the work of the International Crane Foundation and support our global conservation efforts. You can visit the International Crane Foundation, as I mentioned, in May of 2021 throughout our inaugural year and come and see our murals in person. And by paying admission and by becoming a member, that also helps continue to contribute to our conservation efforts. We also have an online store, and you can go there and make purchases. 100% of the proceeds go to directly support the International Crane Foundation. Well, Ben, thank you so much for assisting us with facilitating the questions and answers. And Jay, thank you for helping us think about all of those additional aspects of your work. It was wonderful to have you a part of the virtual art series and joining us today to show us behind the scenes look at painting those murals.
Thank you.
I did want to acknowledge and say thank you to our From the Field sponsors. This project is funded in part by Jody K. Kingdon and Henry S. Kingdon, doctor and PhD, and a grant from Sauk County UW Extension Arts and Culture Committee and the Wisconsin Arts Board with funds from the state of Wisconsin. To learn more about sponsoring one of our webinars, please contact Kate Fitzwilliams. And we invite you to join us for our next From the Field webinar. It is Whooping Cranes on the Texas Coast, an important key to the recovery, with Director of our North America Programs, Liz Smith, and Water Conservation Director, Terry Turner. Sponsored by Karen and Lauren Thompson, in memory of Sylvia Mueller, who loved birds and instilled that love in all who surrounded her. That webinar will take place on Thursday, December 10th at 11 a.m. Central Standard Time. And this presentation and our work is made possible by the support of people like you. Thank you. And please consider making a gift or becoming a member at savingcranes.org. Thank you again, Jay, very much for participating in our webinar today.
Pleasure.